Dear Dhamma friends, today too we are going to have the Dhamma talk. Everyone may get settled down and give the consent with 3 times. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Namo tasse bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhasse. Namo tasse bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhasse. Namo tasse. භගවතු අරහතු සම්මා සම්බුද්දස්සේ ඒකෝ ධම්මෝ ඛානභාග්‍යෝ කතමෝ ඒකෝ ධම්මෝ ඛානභාග්‍යෝ අයෝනිසෝ මනසිකාරෝති Dear Dhamma friends, according to this particular sutta, namely Dasuttara Sutta, Venerable Sariputta teaching the fellow meditators, fellow monks, one by one, most important thing related to one's spiritual life. And after explaining the basic points, today he is asking, do you know that there is one particular thing leading to the diminution or depreciation or backwardness? And do you know that is the unwise attention, and that is followed by the next one, eko dhammo vishesha bhagyo katamo eko dhammo vishesha bhagyo yonusumachika. The next one is exactly the same way. There's another one, the particular thing you have to understand leading you for the distinction, that is the wise attention. So, today's topic will be the wise and unwise attention. Out of these two, unwise attention is being presented first, and with, under the light of that, going to explain the wise attention. So, it's a kind of a cumulative effect of the very first diligence and then mindfulness on the bodily postures with rapture, and then how to be aware and vigilant on your contacts, and with this all knowledges, theoretical as well as practical. Now we are going to present how do one can handle them in order to get the distinction and to do away with this diminution, that is how to on the wise attention and how to get rid of this unwise attention. So, if someone going to start with wise attention and unwise attention, it is not possible unless otherwise one is endowed with the early characteristics. That means one must be diligent, not negligent or vigilant. There is a very helpful character, the first and foremost helpful character for a meditative life. And second thing is, you must love your body. The body must be your best friend, whatever it may be, whatever the posture. And therefore, try to take the bodily posture as the pivotal point, as the reference point, as the benchmark. Being so, still mind may jump into the desirable object, undesirable object, whatever it may be, take the body or posture as the middle path, the pivotal point, or the least defiled state the mind can seek, and you must keep that as a hobby or habit to bring the attention whenever possible to the here and over here. And with that kind of aroused energy, the diligence, be aware within the body how these contacts are taking place. In a given time, only one thing is dominating, but in order to take one dominant touch, someone has to suppress 5 other the simultaneous contacts and one is dominant, all the other five suppressed. And next moment is so swift that will maybe on the same sense door or another, in another sense door, the domination shifted to the other one so swiftly, and you don't feel by taking something dominant you are suppressing five. So in order to aware one individual means five physical sense doors and the mind, and you must develop this vigilance even though you are plugged and connected to one particular sense organ. The other places also accumulating or face to face with or avenued with a lot of other signals, but they never come into the records, they never come into the memory because they have been suppressed. So by taking one sense door or one impingement dominantly, so much you get imbibed into, attracted into, or penetrated into that particular one, so get addicted into that particular one, you are not aware there are five suppressed. But when once you become vigilant and going to continue, at a time you may understand, even though your attention is here, there are a lot of other things are happening. So how to maintain, or how to maintain the balance, how to get the equilibrium, how to get the highest marks and the least frictional path or the comfort zone amidst of this kind of a situation, I would like to present this Yonu Sumanasikara. Or if it is you are inefficient in handling that, it is called Yonu Sumanasikara or unwise attention. So with all the tools in your hand, now you open the floodgates and see at a given time, this is your primary object, or maybe you are already with the primary object. Meanwhile, you are bound to see a lot of other things, hearing, thinking, feelings, daydreaming, many, many things are happening. Under such circumstances, how to find the balance? How to gain the equilibrium? This is a kind of a under the nose immediate experience, never you can gain through book knowledge, never you can buy it in the supermarket, never you can make a commodity out of that, so you can't sell it. So that is the most intrinsic part, so to say, according to the Buddha. You have to earn it with the early qualifications by this kind of a radical way of opening, and ultimately you will understand how to ride the wave, still not to get failed, not to diminish, but to get the distinction. And that I would say the highest challenge in the present day world. So if you wish to give that, or if you wish to give something valuable to your children, this is the one. But first of all, to give it to children or the second generation, our generation must understand this is the most important thing, this is the most efficient thing. And to come up to that level, your mind must find a lot of neurobics, not only one single traditional neuron system. It has to have lot of Y roots, lot of D roots, lot of other alternative arrangements, and you may understand, unless otherwise you put them into practice, they will never used, and your whole brain, you are using very tiny particles, tiny proportion, all the others are never put into use. So it's a wastage. We are not living, we are dreaming, we are fantasizing. So, understanding that to bring the life into being, have a full-fledged life, you must have this Yonu Sumanasikara, or you have to understand the negative of the Yonu Sumanasikara. So, that is one of the most important part in the Vipassana. you don't find this is in samatha. You don't find this is in morality. You don't find this is in generosity. You don't find this is in the being a benevolent Samaritan. You never touch it. When and where you have all these kind of qualities or certain amount up to a certain capacity, still you have to be aware of this Ayonis Manasikara or Yonso Manasikara, then only you know each and every moment is a gateway to Nibbana. Each and every incident is a gateway to Nibbana, and if you do not know, each and every incident is a gateway to frustration, gateway to danger. The foolish person, unwise person, always get mixed up with whenever event taking place. Seeing, hearing, touching, smelling, or meditating, or day-to-day activities, or social activities, whatever may be, anything happen, it be frustration. That indicates, if there is a chance, in a given moment, for your stream of consciousness to become defiled, equal chance there should happen, in the same event, you to get enlightened. If you can understand how your mind get then and they are defiled, that's a very single line or spark or electric line to say each and every moment, if you are vigilant, there's a chance to cut through and go to the Nibbana, maybe split second, maybe momentarily, but otherwise it would have gone to the more and more defilements, more and more frustration, more and more tension. That indicates each and every moment is a new consideration, new chance. So I would like to quote another sutta so that I hope this concept will be more revealed, with examples we can talk about. During the time of the Buddha, there's one elderly person became a monk, Mahalukya Buddha, and came to the Buddha and told Bhante, now I am too old. So give me a meditative object so that I would like to go to a solitude place and meditate. I have no much time to study. I have no much time to do this other kind of thing. Then the Buddha mentioned that you old fellow come and ask like this, and I have given already everything. Still you want to have private consultation. And if you old fellow come and ask, what about the young fellows? How much they should have come? Like Buddha first, at the beginning, he never accepted. He gave a kind of a negation and then put a question. And then get the answer and get into a dialogue. And Buddha indicate each and every moment, whenever you see, the process stop at seeing, but your crazy mind, your egotistic mind, your conceited mind is thinking about this, but you have seen, that is the point where you accumulate defilements. If you can stop at the seeing as seeing, just like a camera, camera never dwell upon defilements. If you can stop just like this voice recorder, it never accumulates any merits or demerits, because it never regurgitated it, re-ruminating it. It's finished. So exactly like that, each and every sense, there is a clutch, there's a brake, there's an accelerator. You don't know the clutch. You keep on accelerating. So whatever the impediment happens, you ruminate it, you re-vomit it, chew it, again swallow it. That is what we call ruminants. Cows are, that is what they do. Daytime they are vegetating and grazing, and evening they go to a safe place and vomit it, and again re-chew it and regurgitate it. So this is the human side. So they are forced to stop at that level. But it was a little bit longer discussion. And then Mahalukya Buddha, he says, Bhante, if I got the point correctly, this is the way I got it. And I would like to present it to you. Please see whether I got the idea correctly. So he mentioned whenever you are uninstructed, how the visual objects impinge into the eye and seeing and then rumination, regurgitation happens, and this is how defilements are happening. And if you are instructed, if you have enough yonisu manasikara, this is how you stop seeing at sea and understand not the visual object, how the eye is working, how the visual consciousness is working. You are not taking attention to the external object, visual object, but you stop at your eye level or your eye consciousness level. And this is how it happens in the ear. This is how it happens in the nose. This is how it happens in the tongue. This is how it happens in your tactile sensation. And that is the way it is happening in the mind. So likewise, he present, have, if you have time, go there and just study it. And exactly the same formula, but given in six modes, according to the five physical senses and the mind, mindo. And I thought of taking the body contact as such. Today in the discussion, also, if I am to cite this as an example, when you are meditating, you feel lightness. It's a kind of a bodily sensation. You feel lightness. And when that happens, if you leave your primary object and going to feel or going to meddle with this lightness, whatever you do, your attention from the primary object is pulled, and whatever you do, you become eccentric. You never understand it's a byproduct. So in terms of byproduct, you miss the main product. So you can't run a factory like that. Byproduct are secondary thing. Your main product is a primary object. Our mind anyway don't give us a chance to understand you are losing the main product at the phase of byproduct. Ultimately, you start storytelling, fabrication, a lot of things. That very thing creates so much of hope or disappointments. Ultimately, your whole meditation disturbs. And next time also, if it's a good one, you may go with the expectation, it never happens. So this is how even the meditation is showing good symptoms due to the unwise reflection, it worked negatively. So Palukya Putra, it is, he put this in example, pasam pusso sati mutha, you feel kind of a tactile sensation, but you are unwise, so you are not mindful. In the sense that you are, your main attention is, we'll say, in the bodily posture or the in-breath and out-breath, that is your primary object. While it is happening, some part of your body, maybe you feel heat, some part cooler, some part lighter, some part heavier. So, away from your primary object, the still body occasionally gives some impingements. This is lighter, this is heavier, this is warmer, this is cooler, this is liquidity, this is cohesiveness, like a lot of other sensation can happen, but you are unmindful. And therefore, now you pyanimitta manasikaruto, sometimes due to your lack of mindfulness or specifically due to lack of unwise attention, the lightness, you appreciate it. Think I am achieving something, I am focusing in the meditation. That is why the lightness happened. This is the first time it happened, like pyanimitta manasikaruto, you take it as a good omen. So that very taking this as good omen, you are losing the primary object that you do not know. Pyanimitta manasikaruto, sarati citto vedeti tancha ajosa tittati. You keep on, sarat means with attachment. It's a desire to this newly arisen lightness or heat or coldness, whatever may be, sarata chitto, with the attachment, you feel it. It is me, it is mine, it is myself, I am the person who earned it. So it going to appreciate in a wrong way, in a unwise way. Why it is unwise? You have forgotten that you are not in the main subject. You have forgotten that you are not with the main object. And now we are on the branches. And keep all appreciation. It is desirable. It is something magnetizing. So this magnetic effect is keep on churning, proliferating, storytelling and fabrication. And that fabrication become your own child. You gave the birth to that child out of this incident because it is desirable. So therefore it is keep on. Dasa vandati vedana aneka pasa sambhava. So you keep on proliferating, appreciating, and that leads to more and more branches away from your primary object. And you will see, you will imagine, tomorrow also I will get it. If I am getting, I am successful. This is a gift. This is a kind of endowment for my life. And I am progressing. Like you keep on accumulating with this sideline or with the branches going on. Abhijja vihesava chittama supahajyati. So you either develop desire or if it is a negative one, hate, and the tension starts. How can I get it tomorrow? Or how can I get rid of that? Both of them are exactly going to get the tension and the frustration moment you leave the primary object and try to go with byproduct, side effects, positive or negative, plus or minus, moment you keep on proliferating, keep on thinking, it definitely going to lead either desire or hatred, and moment they are, you start to develop frustration, start to develop the tension. Evam achinato dukkam. Due to this new income, this is the way you create something. This is the way you create defilements. So you become far away from your liberation. Due to this mishandling of this newly arisen touch, newly arisen sensation, tactile sensation. So when and where meditation happens, your mind, you can't expect to only be with single object. It never happens. If it is happening, we call it samatha bhavana or concentration meditation or serenity. You get absorbed into one object and you will be there maybe 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 1 hour. But mind you, as far as you are absorbed into one object, sure, there will be no cross currents and there won't be any kind of a distraction, but your defilements are never cut off. You are just be in the object and you feel kind of a happiness then and there, but defilements are never tackled. So therefore it is called samatha bhavana. Of course, once in a way you must have that, like you on a long journey, you go to a rest house and take a rest. As far as you are resting, journey is not happening. That you have to understand. But rest house is not a negative thing. So good thing you have to understand. Occasionally you have to take a rest for the recuperation, for the rejuvenation, for the resting. But if you are going to be throughout in the rest house, no journey. Whenever Jnanananda, he give a very good example for that. Hoping this will help. Reveal the situation, I would like to repeat it. You know, in Sri Lanka, in remote areas, only the railway lines are there. So people are used to go by the railway. And whenever, if they wish to have a new railway station, first what they do is take a railway compartment out of the track and use that compartment as a new station, and it is the compartment is meant to travel, but now it has been taken away from the railway and keep in there, starting giving tickets for travelers so that the journey of the compartment is finished. Exactly what happens whenever you on the track, it's moving, lot of objects are there, distractions are there. So whenever you feel tired, you take the compartment out of the track and start ticket issuing to the other passengers, but you don't believe, you don't understand, you are stagnating. This is what happens whenever you try to entertain these samatha experiences. You are no more moving, the compartment become a temporary stationary. So that is, it often happens. So therefore, in yoniso manasikara, instead, if you are well aware of that, if mind is prepared, and if you understand this theoretical presentation, how must be your attitude? How must be your preparedness? How must be your vigilance whenever such a thing happens? He understands, he or she, whenever the mind is face to face with the primary object, you can't expect only that object to be there. There may be a lot of other things happening, seeing, hearing, smelling, touching, everything. Whenever such a thing happens, he never tried to entertain the secondary thing. Never tried to go in search in detail. He tried to reinforce the mindfulness in his or her primary object. Understanding a threat came. So therefore, don't let the mind to run out of the cage. Instead, patisato, establish the mindfulness in your primary object, knowing there is an external threat, external sensation, maybe lightness or heaviness, whatever it may be, pasan. I have taken the example of this touch. It can be easily applicable to seeing, hearing and whatever may be. Viratta chitto vedeti, he never entertain and appreciate the visiting tactile sensation. He understand now my mindfulness is under the threat. Therefore, he be aware of that external sensation, but not with attachment. But is more cautious, more precautious. He knows the secondary thing appear is not a friendly one. Whatever it may be, it is make my mind eccentric, distracting me, but don't try to suppress it. But it is coming due to due cause and effect. So when it is happening, but still you try to establish in the primary object. That's the najosa tittati. Do not try to see the detail of it. Do not try to see the cause and effect relationship. Do not try to note it. Whatever you do is dislodging your attention from the primary object. So therefore, understanding that, you have to more establish, if it is possible, that is what is called, what does it mean by yoniso manasikara, in your object which help you to come up to this level. That is your primary object. And if it is keeping, still you know, my part of my attention or major part of my attention is with the primary object, but I know there's another visitor, another gate crasher. It's there that you are not appreciating, you are not bewildered, you are not entertaining doubts about that. Instead, you become more fixed, get more established on your primary object. At that moment, that Manuka Buddha very nicely says, even though you experience the secondary touch, even though you feel it is desirable or undesirable, still you are not entertaining any doubts. You are sure what to do. You take more anchorage in your primary object. So to monitor in this way, how much patience, how much theoretical understanding, how much trial and error, how much interviews, how much discussions should have happened. And at that moment, No one can help you other than your own understanding. Pasato chapi sevato chapi vedana pusato tapi passana. There is a secondary disturbing tactile sensation. And you know it is very pleasant or unpleasant. But nātyosatittati, you never lose your primary object to go there and to meddle with it, to hug it or to get it off it. You know that is the primary object of this distraction. So you never let it happen. Instead, get a thorough anchorage in your primary object. So under such circumstances, your sati, your mindfulness come into its peak. It's come to the crescendo. It knows, now my mind is already in the primary object. Meanwhile, there are some other secondary things happen. Maybe desirable or maybe undesirable. It may appear like a vision or hearing or smelling or tasting or touching. But I clearly know this is my primary object, which is least with the least amount of defilements. Whatever the secondary thing is going to give, more and more defilements, more you get entangled, more you add defilements. So therefore, you know which one is the safety place, which one is the vulnerable place, and mindfulness is completely protecting, giving a complete picture. As far as you are here, even though you know the secondary object, the tactile sensation or smell or taste or touch, even though you know it is desirable, undesirable, still you are protected. You never try to enter into second one. You never try to appreciate second one. The most important thing is don't talk about that. Whenever you try to go into talk, whatever it may be, you lost. That is called, you are inviting defilements. In the day-to-day activities, whenever we are starting the morning to have some tasks, of course we are not kings and queens. A lot of distractions happen. When such distraction happens, you must understand first thing first. I have to give the priority this one, but I can't stop that secondary lines or distractions happen. And don't talk about distractions. If you are talking, they will get upper hand. You must understand, my task is to do this one. Distraction can happen. Don't take cases. Don't try to be judgmental. They are secondary. And see in our day-to-day activities how much we are talking about distraction. That means we are giving the upper hand to the distraction. You have completely forgotten your primary task, your leadership. So, Who is the leader? No captain. So you also give up your primary task and talking and complaining and demanding highly on the secondary part. So this is why called gossiping. From morning to evening we are utterly gossiping. Our main task is to be with your primary object. That person, this bird, this butterfly, everyone can come and come and can give a suggestion. Whenever you try to meddle with it, unwantedly you are giving up your so pure, so precious, the thought moment, and you feel that secondary thing is much, much important because that precious present moment is boring. That's the main reason. The present moment is boring. The newcomer is always good, whether it is desirable or undesirable. So this is the human weakness. This is the human weakness. So you have to understand my promise, my faith, my discipline, my mindfulness is to maximize as much as possible, be with my posture. If you are talking anything, talk about the posture. Talk about your primary object. And whenever you leave it aside and going to talk about or going to entertain, going to enter into the secondary object, you become your best enemy. The Buddha says, දිසෝ දිසං යන්තං කෛරා වේදීවාපන වේදිනම් මිච්ඡාපන හිතං චිත්තං පාපියෝ නම් තතෝ කරේ. The person who has misguided mind, just like an enemy doing to the enemy, or robber doing to another robber, you are hurting yourself because of your misunderstanding, misguided mind. It is not the secondary person or your neighbor or other person. Your misguided mind is the one creating so much suffering. And you never happy to accept because you are so egotistic. You think I am vulnerable because of due to him or due to that, due to the rain or due to the sun. You have thousand and one excuses. Each and everyone says you have no yonisomanasikara. You have tons of yonisomanasikara. That is why you find reasons externally, and therefore you give attribution to the external thing as souls. They exist. They are. So you keep on making theories. External sources are very powerful. And you are the very fool, make them powerful in order to cover up your egotistic idea. So you have to be very humble and simple. That when and where I am to protect my primary object, when and where I am to protect my present moment, I can't stop these gate crashers. I can't stop these visitors. I have no such power. They can come, and each and every moment, if I am unwise, it's a source of defilements. If I am mindful, I can understand how the mind is working, how I can get the escape out of that. This is what the Buddha, first and foremost, he understood. And the day you will see, the day you will understand it, whenever such a thing happens, get refuge of your primary object. Don't talk about these distractions. The way they come, they will go off. You will be back in the primary object. You may feel it. You may see desirability, undesirability, but you're not worrying. And when such a thing happens, if you wish to explain that to another person, you may find understanding and doing is so simple, but explaining and teaching others so difficult because we are so conditioned. Our mind is so in a rut. Always we are jumping to the newly coming thing and forgetting about such a valuable present moment that is called Kshana Sampatti. So therefore anything comes, the fool make fuss, make defilements. The wise person, let anything comes, he is reiterating and proving, if I am mindful, you become negated. It becomes null and void. I can maintain my mindfulness. So he is again and again proving, reproving his own theory. Ultimately, credit goes to the Buddha. This is the teaching of the Buddha. The Buddha did it, and he never asked the disciples to expect not to happen distraction. He never asked the disciple not to have feeling on the distraction. Both of them can happen. Still, if you are radical or revolutionary in your reflection, each and every point you can get marks. You can understand what the Malukya Buddha is telling, what the Buddha is telling. So at that time, you know your primary object, you know secondary things are happening, and they have desirability, undesirability. And knowing that, you see through. Knowing that, you go through without losing the primary object. So therefore, so much so, or you can put it this way, as far as you are with the primary object, you get the highest protection. Moment you lose it, you are completely vulnerable, and not only that, you are newly accumulating so much of defilements, and ultimately you don't know where these new seeds came in. And you don't think, I have powers, I have skill not to do away with that. You ultimately become inferior. You will keep on blaming the external things. I can't meditate due to this, I can't meditate due to that. So when and where there are no distraction, that is the day I am going to meditate. Till that I will do our day-to-day routine. You have 1001 excuses. Each and every excuse indicate how fool you are, how unwise you are, how unfriendly to yourself, how uncompassionate you are. So much you make external excuses. So therefore, ultimately, towards the latter part of your life, not a single excuse is going to protect you. You are the loser. So therefore, earlier the better, you have to understand, at the beginning, any teacher will tell you, one thing at a time and then done well. So therefore, keep only the primary object. But that is not reality. That is not the reality. Once you develop the familiarity of the primary object, then more and more become seasoned to it, you may understand together with that primary object, there are a lot of other shades of meanings and objects. When you look at this moon in the night, it's very obvious, but more you see away from the moon, there are a lot of stars. Even though it is not up to the size and the light of the moon, they are there. By looking or seeing and observing stars, not a distraction for you to see the moon. That is the point you have to understand. Once you selected and understood or confirmed your primary object, seeing other objects is not always a distraction. It is, of course, a test. You to see, while observing this all kind of things, still can you protect the primary object? Can you still adhere to the primary object more than earlier? That is the way you get encouraged. More to the primary object, more you get protected. Ultimately, you may find for a long time, when you observe the primary object also slowly becoming thin and thin and thin. And it is almost disappearing. When such a disappearance happens, the external objects rationally bound to get more amplified. Your primary object is dwindling, becoming less and less conspicuous, less and less prominent. Other things can happen, it is a sign of progress of your meditation. Your sensitivity is increasing. And there I would like to add one more fact to proceed the talk further. Each and every object in the world have two facets. The face value, the external appearance, or their individual intrinsic characteristics, and some other characteristic common to all the objects. They are called individual characteristic and common characteristics. We know in breath it's cooler, maybe touching on your left nostril, and when you take in you may feel long, short. So you know these are attributable to the or delimited to the in breath, and out breath warmer, maybe in the same place or other place. So at the outset, in the down breath are two distinct objects, two individually distinct objects. But when you keep on meditating, when the breath becomes face to face with you, ultimately you find hardly you can understand the in-breath and out-breath. Both of them are movements. Both of them are activities. Ultimately towards the subtle part, hardly you can distinct, hardly you can notice, you find both of them are energies. So they are individual characteristic at the beginning as far as they are gross. Distinctly you can put into a graph and you can write this is in-breath characteristic, this is out-breath characteristic. But when they become familiar, close and immediate, you find both of them are energies, vibrations. So commonly, common character-wise, they are the same. So likewise, in the primary object and the other appearing secondary objects, immediately when the object comes into your senses, they show individual character. This is a sound, not a thought. This is a sound, not a pain. This is a sound, not the in-breath and out-breath. So that mind can get attracted or you can manage without going there. So more and more you to see these sounds to come without getting involved into your primary product or main object. When it is disappearing, it's also yet another energy came and disappeared. And later you may find thought also another kind of energy. When it is appearing, it is not the thought, not the sound, it is not the pain, it is not the rising and falling, or it is not in within, it is a thought. But if you are to see the disappearing part of the thought, just energy. Whatever the secondary object or first primary object, they are disappearing side, the beginning, the middle and the end, exactly the same. So, if their attractivity, their bewildering power is only at the appearing phase. So, if you be aware, if you have the wise attention, not to get moved by the appearing part, and yet to see through it, how it is appearing, how it is performing, how it is disappearing. If you can manage to wait till the disappearing side, you see, it is yet another kind of energy. When it's appearing, it is very distinct. Sound from the thought, thought from the pain, pain from the in-breath and out-breath and rising and falling and the left and the right, everything. But when you are ceases to exist, at the disappearing part, exactly the same. Till you monitor it, till you digest it, you find the discrimination and differentiation of the object. If you can manage, if you can maintain your consistency, if you can bewilder it, if you can bold enough to see the disappearing side of the primary object, you may see all the other things also appearing like bubbles. And if you manage to see the disappearing side of each and everything, nothing but their energies. It is energy coming and energy disappearing. So, towards the latter part where your primary object becomes subtle, you can still see a lot of things are happening. Thoughts are coming, pains are happening, the sounds are there and visual objects are happening. But you must understand not to get moved by, not to get carried away by. Don't let this thing to take you for a ride. Just wait till they are disappearing. Then you are the master. If you get carried away by the early part, you are a slave. They will come and interpret terms. But your more and more maturity is not only the observation of the disappearing side of the primary object. And with that light, if you can see the disappearing side, if you can manage to see the disappearing side of this secondary objects, ultimately you find the disappearing side, whether primary or secondary, whether it's a thought or pain or sound or primary object, exactly disappearing into the energy pool. So ultimately you find with the appearance and performing and disappearing of the primary object or secondary object, now you master it, situation under control, just energy coming. Energy, dissolving the energy, middle part and the beginning, or at the beginning of it, or in the middle, our mind is selecting, our mind is labeling, our mind is giving a shape. This is a thought, not a sound, not a pain, not the in-breath and out-breath. This is a sound, not the pain, not the thought, not, but ultimately you will understand it is just exactly the energy, different shapes and the different manners. Exactly the same. So ultimately you may find, since I understand this the energy game, why should I get distracted to that part of energy from the this part of the energy? Because both of are the same. Nothing to have the lion's share, nothing to grab hold it, because the energy is equally distributed in the universe. Why should I hold into that? For example, in the world, for the food, I mean solid food, you have to earn it. You have to have your portion, your meal per day, otherwise you are going to die. So therefore people kill each other to have their meal. But in Sri Lanka, water is free of charge, abundance, for the water, no fighting. It is, but here, that the foolish people in America pay money even for water. I'm sorry. Leave it aside. Now, see, think about the air. It's the most important thing, free of charge, whether it's America or in Sri Lanka. We are not fighting. We don't give appreciation also to the air, which is free. For air, are you going to say this portion is me and this portion is my wife, this portion for my children and this is for tomorrow and this is for yesterday? No, because it's abundant and no tension to earn it. But without air, you can live only 6 minutes. Without water, you can live 6 days. Without food, you can live 6 months. You see how much we are envious and fighting and all the kind of work for the solid food. Without that, you can live 6 months. And then the fighting for the water, most important thing, we don't care. Likewise, when you are going to be the primary object and the secondary, everything is just energy. Why should I have my lion's share? We are awake, maybe it is in the energy balance. In the universe, you can't reduce energy, you can't add energy, it is in energy balance. So when you comes to that, you may say it is an endowment. I am also part and parcel of this energy. Why should I have my part or my conceit, my egotistic? You just dissolve into the universal energy. It is called oceaning. So-called your river or my river flow and dissolve into the ocean. And identity reduces, disappears. Once there is water, the river goes into the river, ocean, identity lost. So likewise, when the primary object is losing its boundaries, losing its beginning, the middle and the end, ultimately you become oceaning. When it is happening, if you are with the Yonso Manasikara, you find appearing secondary objects also exactly the same. Don't worry at its appearing phase. That is defiled. That is satanic. That is Marapakha. The disappearing side is Buddha. Disappearing side is Dhamma. Disappearing side is the one Sangha. Disappearing side is the one due to my precepts, I can see it. So just little be patient, not to complain and worry and demand about the appearing side. Just pass through the middle and see the disappearing side, and then you will see the disappearing side, the primary object, secondary object, desirable object, undesirable object. Everything is nothing but energy. So we don't have this enough patience, and we don't know the wise attention. So therefore, whenever something happens, we make fuss, we become tensed, we become frustrated. And ultimately, not only that, you disturb other meditators also. Go and talk. You are going to go with frivolous talks. Because you don't have patience. You can't wait till it is dissolved into that. Once dissolved, you may understand everything is starting from the same pool and dissolved in the same pool. So this is the exactly thing the Burmese shadows made the rule of thumb. When you are mindful, when you are in the mindful state, a sound can come. It may be an attractive one, and may you can see magnetic power to the sound, but still you just don't worry about that. Soon the sound disappears. You can reinstall and re-establish the mindfulness on maybe on your primary object. And then you can make a statement. At the beginning it was mindfulness. In the middle it is sound, attractive or distracting. And then again back to the mindfulness. Make sure that sound never creates any defilements. Because at the beginning, at the end, you are mindful. This is the way, even you listen sound, even you have the attractivity that is not defiling, or it is defiling power, you can make it null and void. This is your skill. Instead telling and complaining and try to put earplugs into your eyes and ears and telling that not to allow to the sound, you become double fool. Not a single fool foolishness. The Buddha's method is not by plugging, not by putting earplugs. Let the sound come. At the beginning you must have, before the sound comes, you must have established mindfulness. Let the mind can come and knock on your eardrums, and you know it's a desirable. And whenever the sound disappears, or its conspicuation or dominancy disappears, if you manage without complaining, without disheartening, come back and establish the mindfulness, then you may find you have heard, you have tasted, but even then stream of consciousness is pure. Undefined. This is what you call Yonso Manasikara. So this Yonso Manasikara you can't purchase by a supermarket. It is not. You can't find a Yonso Manasikara. There are no packets labeled. It is Yonso Manasikara. It is Ayonso Manasikara. But one thing I can say, anything in the supermarket is Ayonso Manasikara. That is why there is no more God. We can go to the mall. That is why the Bodhi is telling, nothing to worry about the God now, God gone, so we'll go to the mall and purchasing and shopping. But the Yoniso Manasikara is such a potential, such a high potent medicine, Buddha mentioned, amidst of all kind of things, you know the see-through method, you know the least frictional path, you know the comfort zone, but, you can't do it amidst of objects. Beforehand, before these objects happen, you must have already established mindfulness. During that time, when you are observing or developing and familiarizing mindfulness, you cut off everything. You go to a silent place and develop one thing at a time and then well. After once it come up to a certain level, don't go in search of distraction, there comes. That is the nature. That is what you call life. Whenever it happens, try to protect. You already develop mindfulness. The main theme is not to worry. If you are worrying, that is called Ayonso Manasikara. If you know how not to worry, instead reinstall your primary object after the episode of the distraction, then you can see mind still calm. Mind not distracted. Even though the sound came and it was desirable, it's not. It is amazing. It's amazing to see still mind as the mindfulness, mind as serenity, mind as concentration, that episode gone without traces. Going without remainder in your memory. It's gone. It is like writing something in the blackboard with a joke and you dust to duster, you erase it. You don't believe, even if your mother dies in front of you, even if your house get burned, even if your child going to have a disaster, still in that, even in that thought moment, the concentration is there. You don't know how to find it. You're always finding something to get worried. So you will get worried. No problem. You have your own rights. But even at that moment, the Buddha says, develop mind fine, yes, mother died, so what to do? What is the point of getting fussy? See your mind, is calm and quiet. You may see, so unfair enough, still it is calm and quiet. That is the Dhamma. That's the way you have to train yourself. And when you are training, you wish, if I have two mothers and still dying, still better. Unlucky enough, you have only one mother. Anything let it happen. Nothing. Nothing happened. The developed mind is so powerful, so anchored, not here and there, the cross currents can shake it. So each and every distraction each and every calamity and disturbance is to refine yourself, fix it yourself, to see your developed mindfulness, your develop your inner qualities. Not a single defilement can erase it all. But you must have this correct perspective. You must have this correct appreciation of your very own qualities rather than your great teachers and the God and this and that. Everything is a distraction. Everything is make you eccentric. The moment you try to depend upon your already earned mindfulness and already earned wise reflection, even though you are not in full enlightenment, you are almost like in enlightenment, you know what to do the next. No doubt. Even if you do mistake, it is for your reification of your very knowledge. You may do a lot of mistakes, no problem. But each and every time you know where the losing point, we have to correct it. So likewise, whenever Malukya Buddha is telling the Buddha, Bhante, this is the, what, the way I understand. If you are unmindfully seeing, hearing, smelling, touching, tasting, each and every time the visitor is going to destroy your peace of mind and it is completely make you eccentric. So ultimately you are accumulating so much of demerits and you are getting yourself far and far away from liberation. But instead, before these things happen, knowing they are definitely coming, be mindful and let them happen. At the peak of their, you may get little frills and distractions. But at the end of it, you are fully re-establishing your primary object. And you may find you have seen something where it was desirable, even then mindfulness is intact. There, you find they have not made any much of a difference to your stream of consciousness, and that give you a determination power. That give you the mind power, how the disciplined mind, how the prepared mind can ride the wave, can see through it, and next time also you may expect, you may be waiting someone to come and distract you, some object to come and distract you, how to maintain your equilibrium, how to maintain your balance. And therefore, earlier it was a distraction and suffering. Now it is just a test. It is just another test for you to test your ability. And therefore, each and every distraction now become a positive mark for you to test. And whenever you be with other people and undesirable and desirable situation, you always go to that situation with mindfulness. Try to come back from that situation with the mindfulness, if that is protected, if that is assured, that means your stream of consciousness up to the maximum you can done away with its demerits. And this is a kind of doing away with the demerits and learning the art. And when and where you install this capacity, understand this ability, the Buddha says, you feel like telling someone, darling, don't get worried. Just be mindful before. And after that also be mindful and see that no one is going to listen. Everyone says, my human right is to get worried. You talk, I am worrying. Okay. Let them have their own dream. And this is such a precious thing for human mind. So you feel like sharing. Don't get worried, just you share with them. Some people, occasionally some people, those who have eyes, those who are ready, they can catch it. And not only it is happening in the presence of Buddha 2600 years ago in the Savatthi and kind of thing. This nature, this understanding, this radical reflection, this wise reflection, beyond the time and space. Any person can have it, but there is no method. There is no formal steps. It's always electric. Always impromptu. All of a sudden it happens. Once happened, it is happened. If it is not, it is not. You can't pump it. You can't give it to your beloved one. You can't rob it. Because it is your own thing. So, the very common thing or very obvious thing the Buddha mentioned is, if you can install this earlier the better in your life. He says if you can cut the life into three stages, when you have black hair, when you have the good vigor in your organs, and if you can understand this, the whole rest of your life is assured that you can ride any wave. Not that you love waves, but if it comes, you ride it. You are not going to show that let the tsunami come, I can ride. No, that is, you are not so fool. Whatever it is happening, you know how to ride the wave. So other people, they are always, their main task or their main human right is find a reason to be worried. Morning to evening. That is what is called gossiping. Instead, the Buddha says, find a reason to be glad, whatever the distraction happens. So that is the way you love yourself. That is the way you develop the inside meditation. And ask it, if you can feel it, if you can experience it. Ask it whether it is depending on the maleness, femaleness. Ask it whether it is depending on the learnedness or unlearnedness. Ask it whether it is for the children or middle age or old age. Ask it for whether it is for Buddhists and non-Buddhists. This is the human nature. This is what we have forgotten. Therefore, we are beastly. Whenever we away from that, we have all the qualities equal to the animals. But this quality, that this one the Buddha is explaining, extraordinary for humans. But even though it is extraordinary, if they are not employing it, if they are not understanding and put into practice, what a waste in the human life. So therefore, in the, throughout the sansara, we have come without understanding. We thought, I will get enlightened by the next Buddha. So therefore, do as much as merits, waiting for Buddha Maitreya to come. And he will preach, I will get scholarship and go to Nibbana. All of a sudden, like an awakening in the nightmare. You never expect that it is my duty to understand, my duty to be mindful before the distraction happened, my duty to mindful to be mindful after the distraction. That is the way Yonasu Manasikara uses it. Oh, that is too much. I can't understand. It is too heavy. That is not the way. I will give enough dhani and expect the Maitri Buddha to come and give a gift like a Santa Claus, come and put a toy onto your stockings overnight. Every Buddhist expects something, someone to come and give that endowment or gift. So they are waiting, doing nonsense. Being busy is each and every moment is a experimental ground, full equipped laboratory. Put into that, the moment you understand it, the moment you experience it under your very nose, then onward, you start to live. Till that you are in a dream. Till that you are in a hallucination. Your own imagination. So, once you understand it, still you are not enlightened, but you know the way, know how. And when it is happening, more and more distraction happens, more and more you will be refined. More and more you will be sharpened. So, therefore, distraction is no more distraction. It's a kind of whetstone to sharpen your weapon, sharpen your knife. So, more distractions, less and less you get shaken. So, that is the point. The Malunke Buddha is telling Buddha, Bhante, this is what does it mean by even you have eyes, even if you see, you know how to stop at sea. You won't carry on with storytelling and fabricating. Even if you have ears, even sounds are there, you know how to stop at hearing. Even if you have other tactile sensations, smell, tasting, touching, don't talk. Don't compare it. Don't relate it to others, because right round you have utter fools. They make that story into another story, and ultimately storytelling, that is what we call the mass media. We are run by mass media. They make one thing and if you read paper, newspaper, whatever you read, you have to understand it is never took place on the earth. That is what you call news. Everything is man-made. And be careful when you are also talking. If you do not know, if you have no touch, if you have no direct experience, tell them this is not my direct experience, so therefore better not to talk. And if you are to talk about your experience, you are dumbbound, because your experience cannot be put into words. Be here and now and try to experience, tell others, nothing you can tell. You are dumbbound. So therefore, whatever sharing is, kind of second hand, kind of deductive. So if it is a why Dhamma Jivamsa is talking on Dhamma talks? Big question. Why Venerable Sariputta is taking Dasuttara Sutta to teach others? Why the Buddha is giving so much of 45 years of incessant way of teaching? Just to enlighten. If you are not listening to this kind of thing, and still if you are talking and this thing, you understand you are misusing or misappropriating the present moment. So try to be as much as possible. And one thing before stopping, I would say, you cannot be 100% mindful in the throughout the day. That is not the task. But the whole thing is to be more mindful than yesterday. And if it is so, you make best friend out of it. Not only that, you are setting a best role model to the sasana and for the other people. And that is the main idea of talking of Venerable Sariputta. So therefore, if you don't talk about Dhamma, Dhammiva Kata, Adhiva Tunnibhava, otherwise shut up your mouth. I am telling you, in this retreat, highest amount of talking I heard for this whole 2500 years, 2015 years. The worst retreat. Everyone is talking. I feel like take my meal and go eat in my room. I don't like this gathering. Because you people don't understand how precious the Dhamma is and you are talking each other. And ultimately what happens? You are going to fill water into this cane basket. So therefore hold your tongue. Try to be mindful as much as possible. And you understand how difficult when someone is fighting and such a way someone is talking, it is unfair. So therefore understand this is something possible for human beings and we have all the facilities and endowments. So give full gear, full energy to be mindful as much as possible when compared to yesterday. If it is so, I would think, I hope, when Sariputta's message is transmitting, we learn unwise attention, we learn wise attention, and without understand unwise attention, you never go to wise attention. Without mistake, you never do correctly. All the mistakes are necessary part for you to see the opposite of it. Comparison. So therefore, my blaming or my finding fault is not a destructive criticism. I am telling you that with respect to that makes more and more restricted, restrained to the present moment, and then you can understand how individually the progress, how the progress in the community as such, and that is the way we have to take highest value for the wise reflection. When Jnanananda put it, a radical reflection. He says it is unconventional reflection. Without that, no Nibbana. So therefore, you have to go into that unconventional thing through the convention. You have to go this traditional radical reflection through the conservative reflection. One day, when you step into the radical reflection, then you are take refuge of Dhamma and you can just put the machine into autopiloting. Dhamma will lead you. Till that, you have to strive. So that is all what I thought of sharing today in the Dhamma talk. Thank you very much for listening.